Caldwell Parish School Board meeting will come to order. Randy, will you lead us in prayer? And this young man's place.
Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity today. I thank you for this opportunity to show up our children, Lord, the children that are going to present our awards, their presentation tonight. We're so proud of them, and we lift them up to you, Lord, and lift this parish up. Lord, guide us in all that we do, that we can make the right decisions for the kids of this parish. Christ's name.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call. Randy Rantz.
Here.
Bo Barton.
Here.
Melinda Ballard.
Here.
Baron Glass. Maria Bass. Gary Castles, Johnny Fallon.
All right, item A is the Executive Committee report, Randy.
Went through all the checks, everything looks fine. The sales tax were up 20% over this time last year, which we have for the last 2 months, but it's down the last 2 months. So everything's coming around and doing a little better.
Thank you, Randy. All right, item B is recognize Bridget Gwynn as the February Employee of the Month. Ms. Freeman from Pelican Benefit Advisors.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good evening, everyone. My name is Julie Freeman, and I'm representing Pelican Benefit Advisors, and I get to brag on one of you all tonight. I want to talk a little bit about Ms. Bridget Gwynn, and it's all good, Bridget. Bridget Gwynn is the field manager for the Child Nutrition Program, and she wears many hats in this position, with one of the main ones being going out to the schools to assist cafeteria managers and technicians with their roles and responsibilities. Bridget goes above and beyond in helping our staff with computer issues, inventory, training staff, ordering, and filling in when we're shorthanded. She is definitely my right hand and plays a vital role in our program, says our director. One cafeteria manager said, Bridget is a very hard worker. She will set goals and challenge herself to achieve these goals just in her own time. She strives every day to put her best foot forward in everything she does, and she's committed to the Child Nutrition Program and will do anything she can to help, even in areas that are outside of her duties. Another cafeteria manager stated, Bridget isn't going to walk away from work, and when she is in the kitchen, she isn't going to let anyone else walk away from it either. She is vocal and most of the time has reason to be. I can and have called on her any time just to talk, and she listens. For 16 years and counting, she will do that for anyone, not just me. She can stay calm and keep a clear, focused mind, even when life is throwing things at her that should knock her off her feet. This award couldn't have gone to a more deserving person. So the plaque reads your January 2024 Caldwell Parish School Board Employee of the Month, Bridget Gwynn, for her commitment, her dedication to her community, her schools, and her children. Proudly sponsored by Pelican Benefit Advisors. I present to you your January 2024 Employee of the Month, Ms. Bridget Gwynn.
Is recognize all district and all state football players. Coach Ed?
Yes. So last month, Mr. Glad, this information had just come out, and so he asked for you all to come to the meeting today. And so I'm going to turn the mic over to Coach Ed to recognize you.
Thank you so much.
Again, talking in front of a bunch of people, that's not my thing, so I want to keep it nice and short. Talking to the boys, I can enjoy and so forth. But I'm really proud of these guys for the efforts they put forth this year. They had to adapt and overcome a lot, especially a new coach, new terminology, new things. We tried to keep it simple, but these guys did a good job. From the list that we're about to call out, you'll see that they put forth and gave me everything that they had, which is all you can want. So first team all district on offense, receiver, Zay Brown. off the board instead. Offensive line, Eli Head. Our kicker, Carlos Sand. Hey, y'all don't get too far back. They want to see y'all. They can't see you when it happens, so they want to see you here. On the defensive side of the ball, first team all district, D-line, Donnie Brooks. Defensive back, I don't know if he made it tonight, QJ Donald. That's good. Opponent, Ben David. Also Ben David. Second team all district.
Offense.
Receiver was Ben David. Offensive line was B.J. Austin. Quarterback was John Paul Shaw. Running back was Greg Jones. On the defensive side of the ball, except this is a guy who I had to play both ways. I don't know if he made it tonight either. Bernard Morgan with D-line. Zay was also recognized in the second team all district as return specialist. Our guys who got honorable mention, starting out linebacker, Dominion Chris. I know he didn't have a chance to make it tonight. Linebacker, Briar Thompson. Center, Ashton Rose. Linebacker, Blaze Dunn. Cornerback, free safety, Jeremiah Swim. O-line, Rick Jarrett. And linebacker, Cooper Williams. We had some, we got special honors of All-State. Eli Head was offensive line All-State. We had two from the defensive side of the ball to make honorable mention All-State. That was Donnie Brooks and QJ Donald. Eli Head also got All-State Northeast Louisiana, which was something that first time I've seen a selection, which we're very proud of that. Donnie Brooks went to the All-Star game and Houston, Texas, the Blue Gray Bowl. So we appreciate him for that. And then John Paul Shaw and Eli both were selected to play in the I-20 All-Star game to represent Caldwell. So very good job. Thank you.
Elective class, so these were the 10 kids that were with me last year. And so
So they joined me for the class this year, and we were ready to go to regionals. So the competition is scored on four different categories, and we actually made a copy of the score sheets for y'all and put them in the folders. And so one of the things they look at is core values, which is how the kids represent their school system, how they work together as a team, if they share the load. And so 10 is the largest team option you can have, and we were the largest team at that regional competition. And so I was very proud of our core value score, which was 22 out of 24. We ranked exceeds expectation in all categories but two, and that's because when they presented it to the judge, it was their very first time, and of course, they were nervous. And so that was one of the feedback that the judges gave us to loosen up and not be as tense. So the other category that we look at is their innovation project, which is the skit that the kids are gonna do for you now. And so every year it's a different theme. And so this year's theme was masterpiece. So all of the Lego interactions and their innovation project had to do with technology and the arts. And so I'm gonna turn this over to them so they can present their innovation project skit to you. They scored a 36 out of a possible 40. On their innovation project.
You can just pretend, right? I need you, though. I need you, though.
I got blue light glasses, so that's not really a problem for me. However, the headphones on my head, it creates too much pressure. It hurts.
If only there was a product that could help us with this.
I know.
Eyestrain, Kipley, I'm listening. I got something for you. This is the APG headphones. The APG stands for Anti-Pain Gaming, which can give you a great time gaming without head strain, and you a great time gaming without head pain.
This is a great product, but I need to know more about this.
We got the idea for our project by starting with the poll. From the poll, we found that our class's majority favorite hobby was gaming. With this information, we decided to research topic problems that have either none or flawed solutions. From our research in Harvard Health, we found problems such as gamer's thumb, eye strain, obesity, and depression. The last two would be hard to solve with obvious reasons as to why. The first one, gamer's thumb, would require a brace or cast that would limit gaming and just be uncomfortable. And that leaves the second one, eye strain, with the easiest solution.
The American Optometrist Association research shows the average gamer spends up to 8 hours per day on screens. 4 of those hours are typically spent on video games. Their poll surveyed 1,000 gamers and found that 48% complained of eye strain, 36% complained of headaches, 35% complained of dry eyes, and 31% complained of blurred vision. We also found that all screens have different chances of hurting your head and eyes. For example, the smartphone has the highest chance of hurting your head and straining your eyes.
Right here is our prototype one. You can see that it was very simple design, easy to use, and overall not creative in my opinion. When asking other teammates around me, they said it could also be too flimsy for breakage, metal clips can easily fall off, causing a hard time to game, and overall not a good design for wearing gaming. So we went on to our prototype two.
We used a 3D model to showcase this and let other people know what it is. These straps right here are to help distribute the pain around your head, so therefore you don't have as much head pain. And this box right here that you see, it fits in a blue light glass that you can get prescribed to your needs that eliminates the eye strain, therefore eliminating both eye strain and the need for glasses, both in one.
So one of the judges was actually a university professor, and so she recommended that we look at other inventor programs and actually take this higher. So I'm going to start looking into that because they can start getting into prototyping, and we've actually revised this model, again, to prepare for New Orleans. The other piece of the competition is the kids have to explain their robot design. So these guys are going to explain that to you, and we scored 34 out of 40 in our robot design.
As you can see, this robot design is not too complex. We have a lift arm to move. We knew we were going to have to lift up arms and push around pieces to complete missions. We also knew the course might be a little rocky, so we built fenders to protect our tires during the course.
So we had many different attachments to help us on the course. So first of all, this is our first attachment that we use. It is very small and easy to attach and put on. And it basically helps us in grabbing things on the ground or on the floor thing, as well as up in the air. We used this piece to push things around as we need certain pieces to go in other places. And we use this piece to flick things, as we found that a lever was in the air, but we couldn't really flick it without having to be precise. So we found that this was the easiest option.
So there were multiple different
missions that we could have completed on the board, and our team decided to do around half of them. We chose this because most of the missions were very time-consuming, and we have a time limit on how long our robot can run for. The missions that we chose were the missions that we could complete the fastest and get the most points from. We also chose missions that we could do easily with no attachments, or this attachment, which is the easiest one that we could put on our robot. Our code was programmed in Scratch. Scratch is a block-based programming language. Our usage of Scratch allowed us to tell the robot how many inches to move, or how much to turn, and when to raise or lower the arm.
And thank you for watching all of that, because this is actually a super secret presentation, so the only people that were able to watch this were the judges and Ms. Watts and myself as sponsors. So this is the first time their parents are seeing what they did as well, because no one was allowed in the judging rooms. So the last thing I want to show you is the actual robot games. They compete in 3 2.5-minute matches, and they take the highest score. And we were not prepared for how intense this is. Y'all can start setting up. Because there's a whole other table right in front with the other school.
They're doing it
at the same time as we are, and we made sure to represent like it was any football, basketball, softball game. We all came in our Caldwell gear. We were yelling for the Spartans, go Caldwell. So it was very intense. So I'm going to go ahead and do it like they did it in the competition. The referee would have us count down, and then the kids need to start. So we're going to start with 5, if y'all count down with me. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. That was, 20 points? Yes, so there are about 15 missions that the kids can choose to compete in. Again, they only have 2.5 minutes, And that first round, like I said, the kids were not expecting it. I was either how like adrenaline filled it kind of was. Anytime they make a bobo, like he just had to grab the robot, they lose what's called a precision token. So they have 6 precision tokens at the start of the mat. If they lose one, there's no points off, but every one they lose after that is a 5-point deduction. Now, you can YouTube the first Lego League masterpiece, and like I tell the kids, these are probably the ones you see that where they earn all 450 points are adults who do nothing but YouTube, who sit and figure it all out. If you watch the kid versions, they're making the same mistakes that we are. We had several instances where, you know, the other kid's robots was running all over the mat and everything. So the way the scoring works is, and how we ended up with first place, is they took the average. So on average, out of all 4 categories, our students placed top. They were first. And going into it, I told them, I'm like, as long as we're not, you know, 8, because there were 8 schools competing. And as we were sitting there and they were calling out the awards, we thought for sure, innovation project, we got that, and we did not. And then it was core values. I'm like, our kids did great. We cheered everybody on, and we did not get that. And then they gave out the next award and the next award. And so we were like, okay, well, we didn't win anything. That's okay. And then they called the grand champion, which was first place. And I think all of our jaws dropped because that was not what we were expecting. So super proud of these kids. And so the timer would go off. I'm not exactly sure what time we're at right now. What are we at? Oh, yeah, 14 seconds. Northeast Louisiana, there's only probably, I think, like 5 of them. So we're definitely representing. A lot of them, you can guess, are Baton Rouge schools, New Orleans schools, the Magnet schools. So we're super proud of them about that. And so the leftovers, of course, will be able to fund the next year's mats and competitions. Because like I said, every year we get new Lego pieces and everything.
Ms. Parker, this is important because I've talked about the marketing, what we need to do with our kids. So all you parents, stand up again, because I want to make sure you understand. You should be proud of your kid.
Amen.
Had we not had this meeting here tonight, you would not have been able to see what you see. We didn't have an opportunity to see it, but we wanted to be able to see it. So what I want to tell you guys is flood Facebook with everything that you've seen tonight. Because what's going to happen is, one of my best friends is the lead engineer at Lumen Technology. And I'm going to make sure that he contacts you. I've already talked to Nick about it. He's one of the lead guys at AI. So maybe this is something that you guys can actually feel as a result of what we're seeing now. Because small towns don't get the opportunity to be seen. Tonight, you guys have the opportunity to be seen. So take as many pictures as you want to take, as many videos as you want to take. And everything you see on Facebook that's negative about Caldwell Parish, it's not always true because this is a prime example of the things that's going right. So hats off to you and your kids and congratulations.
So
Whose camera are we looking at?
Well, it has been my mission since I came to Caldwell back here. To point us on the map in STEM initiatives. And so we've recently partnered with CSILS, which is the STEM Committee Initiative in Louisiana. And so we are represented in Region 8. And any and everything that they have to offer, they email me straight. We'd love to have Caldwell there. They were able to take a trip this year with that class. We went to Louisiana Tech University. They got to tour the campus. They got to do a computer science class. Their favorite part was they gave them a meal card and they got to go eat whatever they wanted in the university cafeteria. But there were so many of them that came out and were like, I can go to Louisiana Tech University. And I'm like, your parents are probably like that because it's an hour away from home. And so they're starting to see all of these options that they have available to them. And they got to be represented as something outside of just sports. Because not a lot of these kids play sports. Some of them don't, Zane does. But, you know, they got to feel what it was like to be a champion.
It's fun, I asked. I asked one of the students and they gave me the answer, but everybody sitting at the table may be a little bit confused about it. I originally thought the young man with the tablet was controlling the robot, but that's not the way it is. So explain to us what makes the robot move.
So they use the iPads to create their scratch code, and there's an option to download it to the hub. So the center of their robot is sort of like its brains, and so you can code up to 14 different scenarios. So when they're on the mat, we don't do the iPad, because with iPad you have to switch to each different screens. So they're able to just press a number on the top of the robot and it'll tell them, this is what I do first, second, third, and so that's
like
shaped
that
our
program?
Time.
Did they write that program?
They did. They all had to come up with their own program, and I am very hands-off when it's in that room. They come up with their ideas. So we started in August, and it started off in just teams of two, and they each were assigned a specific mission. They had to code that mission themselves, and then we came together as a whole team and talked about, okay, what worked, what didn't work, what do we want to move forward with, and then we condensed the code and combined it to what we have now. So, and that was one of the beautiful things, you know, working with a team of 10 that they got a lot of kudos on, is that, you know, they all had a hand in every single thing we did. And the kids that, I let them choose, what do you want to do at competition? And so we had 8 of them that rotate out for the robot games. And then the others, they didn't want that high intense pressure, so they were happy just being a part of the crowd and presenting with the innovation project. So they each got to find what fits best for them and their personalities.
So I will say, I'm gonna brag on Casey a minute, she actually has a master's in STEM. So this is her wheelhouse. She's also our math and science department head. She's on the STEM advisory council for the state. She's also on, what's the other one?
I just became an Ignite ambassador, which is trying to bring computer science to the K-5 classroom. Because I don't know if you've been made aware, but the State Department is currently writing computer science standards for K-12. So that's a huge initiative for the state to give a consistent STEM program for the students and the computer science, because there's a huge need. We learned at our meeting in Louisiana Tech, like half of our engineering jobs and things are outsourced for this state because we don't have the people to be able to do it. So they're coming from Florida or they're coming from Texas, and so there's no reason why our kids can't do that.
She also got a grant to start a coding club. As well, along with the robotics club, and she was our teacher of the year this year. And she participated, so we're really hopeful that she's going to be.
So we can expect to see all this on the computer, right? On the webpage.
Oh yeah.
Because I'm going to definitely look, because I think it needs to be out there.
And when exactly is?
State is January 27th. January 27th. It's at Jesuit High School.
New Orleans, yes, it's in New Orleans at Desolate High School. So, I told two of my students are returning seventh graders, so they'll be with me for eighth grade. And then the way we've been running it is I run sixth grade as just a club, so I just started them. So, if they like it and they want it, then we can push them up to the seventh and eighth grade elective class next year. So, but, I mean, this is something that they can continue to do on as they go through. High school, they have a stepped up version too. I know Mr. Land does something with the high school too. Yeah. Thank y'all. Thank you so much.
Good morning. We want to thank Bob, Mary, and his team for the donation. Resolution to appoint Caldwell Parish School Board President and Vice President for 2024. Brenna, how many committees are
there? Me?
Two.
Three.
Because I know Ms. Johnny, he comes to one of the policy committees. I don't know if he's interested in being.
I mean, that's fine with me. I mean, whatever.
Can we add more?
I'm on the other.
We're just talking about. Well, so, do you want to take Miss Johnny's place on that?
On what?
buildings.
On buildings, ground, and land?
That was only put down. We're going to move her. I thought it was moving.
We can take Randy away.
Come and put Johnny on policy.
Unless you want to stay on.
See, I would love to be on policy. Just to be around Barry and know so much about all this stuff.
Man, I'm about to get off, so.
But I feel like I need to know more.
I'm on borrowed time, man. But no.
If I'm going to be on another one, which is fine, I'd like to be on policy.
Well,
that's something I'd be on the phone.
Because I don't want to get one committee, that's the policy committee.
Are you on?
Yeah, I've been on for 30 years. Yeah, I haven't been on the job, but.
But you're only on one?
Yeah, that's all I want to do. So, I mean, if that's okay, I'll just make a motion that whatever we just said.
So, Chris, can we just put the other one in the policy committee and grab his place? Johnny is Bo's place on the executive. That's all we should check. Item G is a resolution to name Caldwell Watson the official journal for 2024.
I'll back that motion.
I'll second. All in favor say aye.
Nick, are they present?
She texted in, she couldn't go, and she said, get a picture of the board.
Because I would like to have a conversation with the reporting and how they reported to be a little bit more accurate and forthcoming. I don't have any objection to approve because that's the only one that we have, but I guess we need to get our money's worth. Because again, I'm trying to make sure that the public is aware of everything that we do, because there's a lot of good things that's going on and they have a right, you know, to know that. So if you could just relay that, I'm fine with it. I don't have an issue with objecting to it.
But don't forget, they want a picture of all of y'all at the meeting too.
She couldn't go.
But she didn't go.
Do we have a person from there that's present every one of y'all?
They watched the video.
Watched the video?
Before COVID, she was there. December 14th, 2023 board meeting minutes.
I make a motion we approve the December 14th, 2023 board minutes.
I'll
second.
All in favor say aye. Aye. All right, item I is audit presentation 2023, Ms. Lori Woodward of Woodward & Associates.
Hi. I'm Lori Woodward of Woodward & Associates, and I'm here to present the 2023 audit report. So everyone had a chance to review your copy, and we brought paper copies for everybody. To you. All right, so we conducted the financial statement audits. So in our opinion, the financial statements for June 30, 2023 present fairly in all material respects the respective financial position of the school board as of June 30, 2023, and the respective changes in financial position for that year. All right, so this is what we call an unmodified or a clean opinion. You cannot get a better opinion than that when it comes to the audit opinion. So we audited those financial statements and believe them to be materially correct. All right, so in the front of the book, you've got your independent auditor's report. Behind that is the MD&A, which is, you know, that's good reading. It's full of good information, but it's written in kind of a different context than the rest of the audit report. All right, pages 14 and 15 are what we call the overall government financial statements, but these are not presented on a governmental basis of accounting that you're accustomed to operating on. They actually contain a lot of advanced accounting and they're done on a different basis. So most of the boards we work with don't find them that useful, but what you'll want to look at is page 16, starts on page 16, which is the balance sheet. This is on what we call the fund basis of accounting, which is what you're more accustomed to seeing where the, you have the, like the general funds and tax fund and so forth. All right, the balance sheet shows the school board with $8 million in cash and almost $4 million additionally in receivables. Now, those receivables are monies that is expected to be received in the near future with the exception of the property taxes being held by the sheriff's office. All right, we found in our practice that COVID had a major impact on the financials of different schools, and so I opted to compare with 2019 to give you a kind of a snapshot of 23 versus what it was, because financials were consistent for many, many, many years. You always compare year to year to year to year. The COVID, you know, you had more expenses or you had a lot of unusual items. So when you compare with 2019, all right, total assets are $500,000 higher than they were in 2019. All right, total fund balance is $700,000, or 7% less than it was in 2019, but still a positive, almost $9 million. So you still have a nice, solid foundation there. All right, the next page, two pages back, page 18 is going to be your income statement. All right. Here we give revenues and expenses with the difference being given at the bottom. General fund expenses were $1.5 million higher than in 2019 and 1.2 higher in 22. But this was primarily due to insurance expense has increased over $500,000 over 2019. Capital outlay was up $500,000. And of course, we all get hit with those increases in salaries and benefits. So I'm sure insurance increases are being felt by everyone and there's really nothing that anybody can do about it. I mean, I got hit with mine recently and all we can do is hope that they realign the costs and it maybe falls a little bit in future years and we don't have any more hurdles. And likewise, salary increases are being felt by everyone as well. But general fund revenue was $750,000 higher than 2019 as well. All right, so if looking at the fact that capital assets were higher than normal, if we exclude them, it was $1 million, the remaining $1 million increase in expenses was covered by the $750,000 increase in revenue. Overall, sales and property taxes are both higher than in 2019 by nearly $1 million. And MFP appears to have increased, but that's because of those state-funded wages. Federal sources are over $3 million higher due to the stabilization or the ESSER loans. So the big takeaway with comparing 23 with 2019 is that while MFP did go up, it only went up, or appeared to go up 3%, but expenses went up 11%. But hopefully your relief is in sight. Taxes were nearly $1 million higher in 23 than 2019, and of course you've got the green energy plant coming, so hopefully that will help a lot. And these are not unusual for your school either. The difficulties they faced are common among the school boards in Louisiana, and I would expect and hope that the state at some point will be forced to take action on this. In the meanwhile, you do have a solid $9 million fund balance and nearly $8 million in cash. That will go quite a ways. But your business manager is being very proactive in assessing the financial position and proposing any available options. And as with anything, knowledge is power, and having a proactive business manager is a great asset. Through the rest of the report, the column that where it says other governmental funds, those are individually listed out on pages 62 to 67, okay? The notes to the financial statements are loaded with good information. On pages 70 to 74, we detail our opinions on internal control, compliance, and federal programs. And you know, it's usually the first page everybody goes to, but there were no findings this year. Okay? The school board's internal control and compliance have been improving greatly each of the past several audits, and we identified no material or significant deficiencies and no material non-compliances to include those over federal programs. So the required school board agreed upon procedure report is included, as is the statewide agreed upon procedure engagement. Moving forward, the Louisiana Legislative Auditor's Office has opted not to exclude procedures that had no previous exceptions, as they were doing, meaning that these will continue to put a costly burden on all of our entities in the future engagement. And there's nothing that can be done on this other than contacting your legislators. All right, Mr. Sonier pulled a few statistics I'd like to share. This is the first audit report without a finding since 2007. Hey. Out of only nine of the 70 school districts in Louisiana have their audits posted on the legislative auditor's website, which takes a little while after you put it in. All right, of those nine, y'all were first with the date of October 31st. So I want to thank Mr. Sonier and his staff for being very proactive in helping us get the audit completed so quickly. And I can't say a school board we've ever gotten one submitted that early. Yay. I mean, it's great. Yes, you're aware of the numbers, but overall, no findings, no non-compliances. Hard work with staff that did a great job and got it out early, and we really enjoyed working with them.
Oh, thank you.
Congratulations. And we got rid of that last finding because the previous board allowed us to hire a payroll firm.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind. I mean, that was going to stay forever until we had that position locked in. Mm-hmm. So.
And I had no idea until I moved to the office that's on the business hall how much they do. It is unbelievable how hard all of the business department works and how efficient they are.
So. We try.
Now, Ms. Wood. How much did David pay you?
No more than necessary.
Good answer. Yeah. Thank you.
Good job, David.
Thank you. So we're very happy in the business department. You know, we got a great staff, as y'all are all know. But I mean, it dropped off. So wouldn't trade any of them for anything. Thank you.
All right, thank you. All right, item J is approved with one-time stipend of $250 in 2024 for maintenance personnel, George Nugent and Donald Martinez.
Hey, Nick, have they ever gotten a cost of living increase because we've been here with $250 for how long, David? It was before you got it, but give them the $250
stipend. It's a reoccurring.
Yeah, but it's been years that they've been getting $250 and everything else is going up. So have we considered upping it?
I kind of thought this was a James item.
Well, we're not going to do it tonight, but I'm just saying everything is going up. $250 is not the same.
I'm certainly open to it. I mean, we're only talking about 40 people, so yeah. We're not talking about.
Well, it's just one is leaving, so we took one off.
Well, I don't see why we could just offset what we were paying and just divide it between the two, because again, they need it. Yeah. So whatever we was paying the other two or three, just divide it between the two, and let's just give them that.
I'm okay with that if y'all.
So if it was
$250,
you're
talking
less than
$1,000.
What's
$750
divided by two?
Well, it's $750 either way. $750 with three people, $750 with two people.
Yeah.
It's what y'all are saying,
right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
there's
no real change.
Yeah.
Is this a yearly thing?
Yeah.
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 So what happens
when we're not
another person?
Well, we approve it every year.
$1,000 a year at most.
I just don't want anybody to think that when you hire another person, that same person is going to get $375 or whatever it is that we have been increased to, correct?
Not when they hire.
When do they get this?
They get it once a year,
and from what I remember, I hate James in here to talk about it, but I think it's to help buy their work boots.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The
that's what I remember.
Right. Yeah.
They can't just go buy it.
I'd like to reward people for what they're doing. And everything is going up, 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 up. And they're still getting the 250, which, you know, a pair of boots is probably costing me.
So,
I mean, don't insult is what I'm saying.
I mean, it's more of a reimbursement than a performance or, you know, for late. And obviously.
I'm down for it. I'm just, I'm like, we say one's leaving, but we're going to hire somebody out of the meeting.
So the total increase would be, we have 250 times three people, so that's what, 750? And now we're talking about 1,200. If we went to 400 apiece, is it the difference between 750 and 1,200?
Are they going to hire someone else?
Sure.
I hope so.
They had three, why would they lose?
Yeah.
One's fixing.
He's leaving for another job.
I mean, I don't see why we could give $300, $400.
We didn't say that when we gave you the person that we just gave you. So, I mean, let's just be fair across, you know, the spectrum.
I'll say it again. I'll make a motion to give $400.
And I'll second it.
I think they deserve it.
All right.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, you know,
I'll do roll call.
Let's do roll call.
Okay, do roll call.
Okay, Mr. Rance.
Yes.
Mr. Barton.
Yes.
Ms. Ballard.
Yes.
Mr. Glass.
Yes.
Ms. Bass.
Yes.
Mr. Castles.
Yes.
Ms. South.
Yes. That's where they can borrow a good jacket, too.
Four.
They don't make it next one. When do they get that?
Next payroll.
Right.
Yeah. All right.
So January 25th.
Mm-hmm. Okay, is financial update, David?
All right. I tested y'all the same information earlier, just so y'all have a chance to look at it in case y'all wanted to peruse it before. Really, not a whole lot going on as compared to the prior month. General fund is kind of rocking along about within expectations. I still think we're probably looking at maybe $350,000 deficit, which is where our budget was. Sales tax fund is doing a little bit better. Lunch fund is doing okay. It's been hammered by supply costs, and that's just how it is. I mean, it's unfortunate. We're probably making an additional $40,000 or $50,000 in revenue based on how Sandra's able to get us to 400% reimbursement. All that's being spent on food cost increases. Sandra, have anything else? Yeah.
No, that's pretty much it.
Okay.
Food and supplies.
Yeah.
How's the breakfast cart working?
I've been good. I mean, we haven't seen a significant increase, but I think the kids enjoy it. And
you think the junior high would like it too? The junior high's percentages are good.
Yeah, they, I don't know. They might really.
If they're working it, but if it's working already, then.
Yeah, junior high's breakfast is pretty good. I think they have most, all of them, don't
we?
But that is a thought to look at because, I mean, it is, it's eye-catching and I think, you know, the kids are
not.
It's different. Yeah.
I don't know if we've ever told y'all this, but every month, like I told you, James gives the principals their energy report. Sandra also reports each school and what their percentages are for breakfast and lunch. And so they kind of compete with each other to try to stay above. She has her goal there, and then every month what it was, and then what it was the previous month. So try to keep them on top of that. And we've met our goal.
Yeah. Yeah. District-wide, it's 60% for breakfast and 80% for lunch, and we're a little over that for both.
Okay. And then maintenance fund is doing a little bit better than the prior year, and that's just, it'll depend on repairs. And last year at this time, we've had more repairs than what we had at this point this year. Could change next month. Might not change. Who knows? And that's all I have.
All right. Thank you, Dave. All right. Our mail is resolution to vote on opening three CDs for $500,000 each with a three-month term.
Yeah, we just have extra money for a little while from property taxes coming in, and all it is locking up money for 3 months in order to earn a little bit of extra interest. This will get us an extra $18,000. We left it just in the money market, we can get about $14,000. So we're making an extra $4,000 over the money market. Right. So that's all that we're wanting to do.
And you're putting all three CDs in one place?
Yes, just out of simplicity. Last year we had it all with Homeland. This year we're going to have it all with Citizens. and next year I would assume that we're going to put it all at Caldwell Bank. So that way.
What's the rate?
Bank.
What rate are you doing?
Right. 5%.
That's good.
So.
You think you'd better rate than that?
I don't know
that you would get any more than that, but they're all going
to have to. Homeland was giving us 5% on $1 million 2-3 months ago. So, I mean, it's what we got. So, and I think it is
five
also.
Percent is really good.
I think 5 is a very good rate.
It is.
Yeah. Well, I make a motion we do this.
Thank you. Second.
Awesome.
All in favor say aye. All right. District leaders update.
We don't have any. You want to do Monica's real quick? So
yes.
Monica's at a conference.
Monica is in Shreveport at the Louisiana Head Start Board of Directors meeting. Everything is going well, and 25 enrollment is slated to start in March and April of this year.
You don't really have anything?
Ms. Files?
Well, we're getting ready to get started on our 2025. And also I'll be setting up a meeting with my public school, Bubba's the new principal there. And our program will offer them services. Any federal funds that we get, we have to offer it to them. So we'll be doing the affirmation and consultation meeting next week.
Why is that? Why is that?
Because they're a non-public school, and we have to give them services. We don't give them money, but the government said we have to offer them.
So if they have a student if they have students that need services, you're saying that we have to provide that?
Well, if they decide they don't want money, any kind of, we don't give them the money.
Right.
We just give them the service.
Right.
We order stuff and I deliver it to them and inventory it. But
paper, whatever.
But supplies. And the town too, and the town consultant, they want to get some consultants in. I have to set it all up. They reap the benefits. We have to do all the work.
Yeah.
But that's why it's the economic services to them. So they usually get one town or two. And Title 4. They don't want the Title 1 because they have to send out those free and reduced meal things, and they don't do that. Why are you going to private school? And you're going to want free lunch? And usually they don't do that. So anyway, we just offer them services, and they either take it or not. I worked with Tamara a long time on this, and never had a problem, because they didn't get past Title 1 money. But they did Title 2.
So how many places in Caldwell that received our
services?
How many schools?
It's only one private school, Bethel.
Just on Bethel? Mm-hmm. Because I know there's others.
What's that?
I know there's other.
There's like little church schools.
They have to be on the approved list, Bloomfield God list, in order to receive those services. And if they are not, they can't get it. But, it's a long time before O'Belton came on the Bloomfield God approved list. And all of those schools made Harvard's have loved lovely, but they're not approved by the state. They're not entitled to any of those things.
Thank you. Ryan, you got anything for technology? You're standing in from like tonight.
We got some crap, so. Slim report.
Yeah. All right.
Okay. All right. So I will just kind of say what they've been doing. They have been Maria's literacy team, and she's had Rebecca Meredith and the interventionists and Kim Adams. They've been doing all the mid-year DIBL screening for our students, so they've been hopping with that. We are watching the weather. Just kind of waiting to see what's going to happen. Our concern, James and I have been talking with the sheriff's office, the concern is Monday night, freezing temperatures and wet, what it's going to do Tuesday. So we're just watching right now and not trying to be, you know, too jumpy or not responsive. So we're doing that. I did give you a copy of the vacancy report here. I have to give this to Dr. Brumley at the State Department every year. And so just so you kind of know, at each school, the certified teachers and whatnot, and over to the side, if it's in red, it was changes in October, blue was changes in November, so green, you can see the most recent changes that we have. We did have, we're able to hire two certified teachers that either graduated or moved back, and then we had two of our non-bachelor degrees teachers who graduated, and so we're moving in the right direction, and it's nice for me to be able to put those numbers over in a different category, and so less long-term subs. So excited about that. The other thing I put in here is we did the mid-year teacher survey. I emailed this all to you. It was every school had their own survey, and there were questions that they had too. We really pushed hard to get high number of percentage of teachers to participate, and so we actually had over 80% at all schools, and some schools had 100% of their teachers participate. So we definitely have their voice. I gave you a copy of just the high level district results that kind of let you know. Super proud of the positive percentages that we received. I go back when you said, Bo, last time, if you're 50% or better, I told them, I said, y'all remember that, because we're way over 50% in all areas. Definitely have some places we need to work, and so what they're going to do, I gave you this copy, I'm meeting with the superintendent's teacher advisory council next week, and so I'll go over the results with them. They were instrumental in helping me draft the questions for this and then getting people to participate in it. And then we have our half-day PD on February the 2nd. They'll dismiss at 12. And so each school is going to go over the school-level results with the teachers and have them brainstorm ways that they need can fix things or the problems that they have and try to really work on solutions for any areas that are at each school. So super excited about those results and wanted to share those with you. We are working heavily this semester with the Louisiana Workforce Board and Rebecca Meredith with her transitions grant and piecing those together. Baron, what are we meeting? December with Katrina?
Yeah, December 16, 17,
18, 1. Okay, we met with them and then today we followed up and we've got meetings with Shay Evans, who is from here, she gave us her last name, to work on some parent engagement for our students. We've got a meeting with Shelly Barton with The Haven next Friday to look at the CNA program. And so that's hopping and moving, and we're very excited about that in preparation for when Louisiana Greenfield is here, construction and everything moving forward with that. So just making sure that our graduates are ready for the jobs that are coming. So we're very excited about that work. And then Kaylee wanted me to remind y'all about the LSBA conference, March 10th, 11th, and 12th. Let her know if you're going to attend the Baton Rouge this year.
Go ahead and tell you now.
Yes, I
can. I'll be going.
Okay.
You already got me now.
Yes, sir. I'm going.
Luncheon today for the one of the schools meal. It was really good. I really appreciate it. And I also visited the school, went around, talked to, listened to the teachers teaching. And, you know, you're always saying we want the kids to think for themselves. And I was in a classroom where she was trying to get these kids to be more thinking about what they're doing, you know. And it was really interesting. I really had never seen that.
Okay.
It was really interesting.
I
know they
would like
to see you.
We just got to get you to talk to me. But Nick, I got a chance today to visit the PLC.
Oh, good.
And I want to say Mr. Amos is doing a wonderful job. And one of the concepts that I left with, and I hope that you make sure that all the teachers kind of adopt, which is the love and
logic
concept. It puts you in a position to where you learn what you need to learn and teach what you need to teach. And the choices that he was given with the teachers that were in there, I think it was very good. He did a very good job. So if anybody's able to go tomorrow, I think it's 10:15, 11:15, 12:55, 1:55, and 2 or 3. I'm going to try to make another, but I guess because people always say that we're not doing nothing. And when you always see it, you know, on the paper, I was arguing with somebody today that the integrations and all that other stuff wouldn't. And I hate to debate it because it's, I see that it's working. Mm-hmm. What he's doing is just wonderful. And I don't know what we're going to have to do to keep him, but if you guys were to see it, he's amazing. He's just got a way of relating to the teachers. And I asked the teachers how they bind into it, and they were able to explain to me this versus that. And they said, well, you know, the problem is if we have. So I said, well, what I would advise you to do is get with a link, get with whatever the group that we just put together. What's the young lady name? The group? What do you report? you know the group with the teachers, whatever.
Oh, the staff. The superintendent teacher advisor.
Yeah, I told them to get with them.
Yeah.
And whatever recommendations that they have, don't be afraid to, you know, speak on what you feel like you need to speak. And I also told them that the form that we did, the 10-page, 12-page survey, they can always use that.
Yeah, and that's what this
is. And I strongly encourage them to use it. So they said that they weren't upset or disappointed. I think the buy-in is coming, maybe a little bit beyond what we thought, but I believe that we can get there, provided that those in the role of leadership can just understand that everybody will have to agree, listen to them, and try to, you know, let them be a little inclusive. But I was very.
And there are areas, as you go through the survey and look at, I mean, because we're. With our district strategic initiatives that we wrote, I mean, there were overall district goals, but one of them, of course, is in the teaching and learning, which is the TCPs and the observation and feedback. So there are questions on that. There were teacher professional development. Do they feel like their time is well spent in TCPs, and are they learning, or are they supported? In the new teacher onboarding, because we want to make sure our new teachers feel like they're supported and want to stay. The social-emotional learning, which is the teaching with love and logic. And when Mr. Amos shared that, every Tuesday, Monday usually, he sends me a status report, and so I'm able to go through and look at what he's doing and click on all of his links. And when I saw that teaching with love and logic, I was like, you are speaking my language. I love this. But he took even everything in his TCP and he related it back to our district goals. Right. And so every time it was, this is the district's vision and here's what the school is doing.
Yeah, we don't need to lose him.
No, he is in his element. Yeah. So you've got workplace belonging and then recognition, culture, data-driven instruction, and cultural awareness and teacher awareness of student motivation. So all of that comes together. And so I'm so glad that you were able to go.
What at the high school?
In room where were we the other day? 143?
I think it's 143.
Right next to the teacher's class. Yeah.
It's like 2 doors down from where we're off.
Is it 143?
Do you have the number?
I think it's 143.
143.
It's the example of the office.
You went today too?
Yeah.
Good. Y'all.
I was going to try the other day, but I didn't want to go.
It's all right. Yeah. And you know, it's just so much on the teacher to where, I mean, you can't balance it. You just have to be, you know, forgiving with them because they got to do this, they got to do that, they got to do that on top of everything else. And then they got to try to educate the kid. And sometimes that's not a good environment because you got kids that just don't want to be educated. We got parents that don't care for educating. And the teacher's trying to educate. So,
and that love and logic is going to help teachers be able to deal with
students.
You
can use that in life. It's a good concept.
It is.
Yeah. And so hats off to them.
I think you had one thing that I just thought about because I saw it on the calendar. Aren't we hosting the first powerlifting meet tomorrow?
It is on my calendar, yes.
I think it's the first.
At 4 o'clock tomorrow, I put it on my calendar because I wanted to go to it. At 4 o'clock tomorrow, it's the first one. The first one we've ever had that I'm aware of, yes, but our powerlifting team is having it's a try meet. And I think it's in the final marks. Yeah.
Are we going to have a track meet here?
Yeah. We're hosting. Yeah. The high school's hosting two, and the junior high's hosting one.
One for sure.
One for sure. Yeah. We just got hurdles. We just got hurdles. Yes. Yeah. We are.
Anybody else?
Let's keep bearing sister and our courage. I know he's real quiet tonight. I know he's got a lot on his mind. So let's keep him out there.
We lost a classmate of mine.
When he was in his element, he was good.
And continue to pray for Will Springer. He went and got his scans on Monday, and I've not heard the results.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
All right, your motion we adjourn?
I make a motion we adjourn.
I'll second.